What's going on, guys? What's going on? It's Zeke Diddy. Nah, it's just Zeke. Another wonderful day in California. Just wanted to hit you guys up and do another live. I think going live is going to be the new thing for me. I like the show we did yesterday. Let me see if I can find some stuff. I'll wait for you guys to occupy the room. Still waiting on folks to get in here. There we go. We got a nice little reaction. Thank you. I don't know who's here yet. We got a great show for you guys today. We are going to be talking. We got a great day in video. We're going to look over. I just posted it, so you may have just recently watched it. We'll talk about this Pampered Pity that's been going viral. See that dog everywhere. We'll check out one of those videos. I got a warble video that I did years ago, one of my early videos. This is still back in the Bully Badass TV days. And we're going to look at a Giant Schnauzer versus Doberman video. What's going on, DL King, Ruru, Rachel Dowd, what's up, RKBB, what's going on with you? RKBB, where you at, man? Where are you in the world? Mark Guilfoyle, nice to see you again, brother. It's been a minute, man. I feel like I see you almost every week because I, for whatever reason, your wife's, she's in my Facebook feed, so I'm always up to date on what's going on with you and the family. What's going on with you, Mark? Tawan, RKBB again. Ayada, what's going on, guys? What's going on? Thank you for the compliment. Thank you, thank you. Let me see. So I'm trying to do something real quick. Shit, we're not gonna worry about that right now. We're gonna jump into this. Keep with the roll call. Tawan still there chilling. All right, guys, we're going to get going. Let me organize my screen and get ready to get everything set up for us to have a wonderful show. Godspeed, what's going on with you? D. Reed, what's up? I love the Shepherds. They're not the dog for me, but I think they're a great breed. Kind of like Belgian Malinois. Great dogs, you know, great workers, but not something that I would want to have to deal with 24/7. And dogs like that you have to deal with 24/7 at very high energy canines. What's going on, Capricia? How's it going? Keenan, what's good? Let's see here. Up to 46 folks. Everybody, if you haven't already, subscribe to the channel. I'm pretty sure all of you guys, your early adapters, you guys have probably obviously already subscribed to the channel. So let me tell you what we're doing and what I'm going to be doing. What's up, Carlo? What I'm going to be doing in these lives is I'm going to be kind of looking at dog videos, sharing my sensibilities, my opinions. On what's going on in the outside dog world. And we're also going to be taking a look at a couple of the videos that I produced over the years. Oh, man, with Marky, I wish I would have brought up that Kangol video, one of my favorite videos of all time. Definitely a top 10 video, I feel, on the channel. Well, we'll do that soon, though. You know, that's a heavy hitter. So it's going to be coming up very shortly in the rotation. But what I'm doing with these live videos is trying to, you know, interact with the community, get an idea of where you guys are as a community, but also give you guys a look into the back end of Dogumentary TV. Myself as a filmmaker, you know, what I do in a lot of ways to make the films, what happens when I do make the films, but then also share with you again, my sensibilities as a dog lover, someone that loves dogs as pets, but really has a fascination for the working dog. So that's what these lives are going to be about. If you guys, I don't have a time right now, set time, because my schedule's so hectic, but I'm going to work on, you know, trying to do these regularly. And if you don't catch them live, I mean, they should be just as entertaining, you know, watching them later on or that's when they're not live. What's going on, Brandon? J.E., Cowboy Wash, J.R., welcome to the room. Appreciate you guys. Welcome to the room. I think that's that shows how old I am, right? This isn't a room. This is the live. I guess this is a live. RKBB, I didn't catch where you were from, though. I see you've been doing this for 6 or 7 generations. Where are you from? What part of the country are you in? Coach, I'm not in the Inland Empire. I'm in San Gabriel Valley. I'm not in the Inland Empire. Although I have been looking at houses out there. There are some nice homes out in the Inland Empire, but my wife doesn't really want to move too far away from where she works, so we probably won't be going out there no time soon. You're in Bakersfield. Okay. Well, RKBB, do me a favor, bro. Hit me up on Instagram. Like, send me a DM. I don't know why you can't DM on YouTube or whatever, but send me a, if you, I'm on Under Documentary TV, shoot me a message in Instagram, and I'll try to reach out to you. We could talk about something, because, you know, Bakersfield's not that far from me. I drive through Bakersfield all the time. What's up, Khalil? Thank you, brother. So, like I said, we have tonight. It's a Friday night. Hopefully you guys are getting ready. The younger folks are probably getting ready to go out to the clubs. You know, old folks like myself, I'm just waiting for my daughter to get home from softball practice. We're going to go have a nice quiet dinner, probably watch some TV. The sun's down. I'll probably give the dogs a short, you know, maybe 20, 30-minute walk. Then that's it. It's a wrap. 10 o'clock, I'm in bed. I'm ready to go, you know, call it a night. Daniel Brown, what's going on with you? Florida Fish Fry, what's up? I appreciate all you guys coming and checking and hanging out with me. Yeah, I hear you, Jay. No clubs, no more clubs for me, brother. I'm done with that. Over that. All right, so let's jump into this first video. What's going to be the first video? Let's do this Pampered Pity video. I know you guys love pit bulls for the most part. You know, a lot of my community, we love pit bulls. And this isn't so much a pit bull video. It's kind of like a social commentary on a lot of other things going on. A lot of other things going on in the world. Not necessarily in a bad way, but it says a lot about how we treat dogs and how dogs are treated today. So let me first find that video. It's right there. Let me do this. There we go. Let me center it up for you guys. There we go, perfect. I mean, if you guys recognize this cute little dog right here, this dog is like he's taking over my timeline in TikTok, Instagram, and YouTube. It seems like every day I get like 1 or 2 videos of this dog. And this is a beautiful dog. Let's take a quick look at this video, though. Let's take a look.
Your dog is not a human. Your dog is not a baby. Do you know how many comments I get like that on the daily? I do not have any human children, but this right here is my child. He did not choose to be here. I chose him. So that means I'm gonna make sure that he is fed. I'm gonna make sure that he's comfortable in his skin. I'm gonna make sure that he is loved. I'm gonna make sure that he gets everything that he needs. He is going to be spoiled.
I noticed that Rain was having skin conditions. It was my first time having a pit bull, and I didn't know that they have skin issues. And so I used to feel so bad when he was scratching and itching all the time. It made me feel so sad. I would always take him to the groomers, and I would take him to the vet and buy all of the products. And none of them were just working the way that I needed them to work. So I just started doing my own routine at home. And I just kind of started doing the things that my mom used to do with me when we had dry skin. Rain enjoys being bathed and pampered. He loves it. Rain is probably thinking like, wow, I really love her. Because that's what I'm thinking. But I will literally stop and give Rain like 50 kisses and then we'll start again. He's so cute to me. He's just so precious. I do a lot for him, and a lot of people find that it's just too much for a dog. But honestly, Rain is my child. He has been here with me through everything. And I would literally do anything for him. And I'm so glad that I feel like he knows that. This is the way that I show my appreciation. I'm just an extra dog mom.
We are about to let Rain out so that he can check out his little birthday surprise.
I try to take every chance that I get to make sure that Rain knows that he is very special to me and that he is very loved.
All right, guys. So as you can see, that was a video that was posted on Dodo. I'm sorry. And before we jump into, you know, my thoughts on that, first and foremost, I saw I believe it was Carlo said that wasn't a pit bull. I mean, I'm like, what am I, 15 years into this, man? I don't even argue about that no more. If it's not a pit bull, tell me what it is. I mean, I understand, like, you know, when you're dealing with the world, when you're dealing with the spectrum of the dog world, from like hardcore pet owner, hardcore working dog, I don't argue, fuss, or fight about labels or whatever. People call their dog a pit bull or whatever. I don't argue with them. It's not a fight to be had. A dog is what a dog is. I do understand how, on some level, you know, the mislabeling of breeds has been detrimental to breeds. But in the case of this woman right here, I just feel like what she's doing, like, you know, for, like, let's be honest, like, she believes she has a pit bull. 99% of the veterinarians in the world, if she took that dog to him, will tell she has a pit bull. To me, it's not an argument. It's not even worth a fight anymore. If I walk that dog down the street, 99% of people are going to think it's a pit bull. And it doesn't matter unless I try to go work that dog. Then it matters. And so if I'm not talking to somebody that's working dogs, I don't even care what you call it. You know, I'm not having those fights or arguments anymore. But what I did find, or what I do find fascinating about this young lady, I believe her thing is Rain, the pit bull or something. R-E-I-G-N, Rain is the dog's name. What I find fascinating about that is it's more of a social statement, I think, she makes. And, like, to me, you know, and I don't want to be Me Too or none of that stuff, but to me it looks like she even needs a husband or some children, right? If you have that much time to spend caring for a dog, then I think you're looking to fill that time with something else. And I think if you don't want children and you don't want a husband, that's fine. You can have dogs. I know a lot, there are people like that, I guess. But I would say your time would be better spent with some children or a husband. But she takes great care of the dog. I mean, the dog is aesthetically beautiful. Like, he's clean. His hair, his coat is shiny. Obviously, his teeth are white. He's well-fed. One of the things I find in the feeding process, she feeds him a mixture of I guess you would call it human food and kibble, which I think is a little contradictory, right? Like, we don't want to, I wouldn't do that. The other issue is that she basically, she seasons the food, like, and I don't even understand how seasoning dog food, like, I don't know, why would you season a dog's food, but that's what she does. So those are two things I think, those are things I think are kind of an issue, but not necessarily a big deal. Obviously, the dog is loved, cared for. He has a huge following on TikTok and I'm sure on Instagram. And she loves him. So that's great. Me personally, I love my dogs in other ways. I love them by letting them be dogs, giving them activities that they enjoy, giving them a safe, happy home, feeding them a raw diet, unseasoned, a variety of proteins from fish, chicken, beef, lamb, some pork, not as much pork, but pork, and, vegetables here and there. But, that's about it. I have another video I wanted to share with you guys. It's another YouTube video. It's from a channel called, his name is David Windmuller. Now, this is going to be more of a reaction video. Just so you guys understand, like, what I'm doing in this with these lives, I'm pulling videos off the internet just to kind of open up the canine diaspora that I deal with on my channel, so that I can talk about not only my videos but other things going on in the world. Because I can't produce, I haven't produced but so many videos. I haven't covered all these topics, but that doesn't mean that they're not interesting and things that I want to talk about. So, let me see. So this next video is David Windmuller. I guess that's how you pronounce his name. And he posted a video. He has a small YouTube channel. You can actually find him under his name. I would recommend that you check him out. If you like his content, subscribe to the channel. I mean, obviously, he's just starting out, it looks like. He has 2,400 subscribers, so he's well on his way. But that's a channel that you guys may want to go support. Let me do this real quick. All right, let me set it up. All right, guys, let's check out this video.
Recently, our family bought a giant schnauzer puppy from a very good breeder after 8 months without a dog. 8 months ago, we lost our dog, Kazi, to cancer. Kazi was a Doberman from another very reputable breeder. He was an amazing dog. And with my family, we thought it was time to finally get a replacement. So what do we want to replace with Kazi? Well, you can't replace Kazi, but there were traits we wanted to replace. Some of those traits were that he was just a very good family dog. We had a lot of farm animals, and he generally just left them alone. He did what he wanted to do, but he never really bothered our chickens or ducks or goats. While the chickens and ducks and goats wanted to mess with him, he never caused them any harm. Kazi was very protective. We have about 2.5 acres here. Those 2.5 acres belong to him. He patrolled all day. Whenever the girls or other and all my nieces and nephews went outside, he went with them. He was there to watch over them and play with them at the same time. And he was always a companion with them. But he knew if they went outside, he was with them. He was great. He was great as a guard dog at night. We had to close up the garage, chicken coop, check on the goats and stuff. It was really dark out. He was always there right by my side, doing all the checks, barking at things that needed to be scared off. So very good for that. He also had a really good presence. When we went out in public, his demeanor was very calm but confident, and he wasn't the friendly dog that most people met when they came inside our house. He had a classic Doberman look. He was very strong and muscular. He was also extremely athletic. He was constantly jumping our 4-foot fence when he wanted to. Out in public, Kazi always got us a very wide berth from people. No one came close to us. He was super intelligent. It's almost as if he could understand English and pick up concepts really fast, especially towards the end. He was really intelligent. Also, being a doorman, he had very short hair, so the hair that he did shed wasn't a lot of hair. It was very small. So those are things we liked. The only trait that I didn't like about Kazi was how he handled cold weather. Because he had such short hair, he had no like undercoat or anything. Man, it was really tough for him when it got cool and cold. Even air conditioning would get him cold in the summer. If it was too cold in the house, poor guy, he was suffering. You know, as I stated in another video, me and my family, we were supposed to move to Colorado, and so I needed a dog that could handle a much longer and much colder winter. And so a Doberman was not the breed for me. So what were the breeds that I looked at? So let's again remember, I wanted a family dog, I wanted a guard dog. I wanted a dog that was athletic. I wanted a dog that had a commanding presence, something that people would think twice about when looking. Didn't have a lot of problem with shedding of hair. And then the last thing was that it could handle cold weather. So basically, I just wanted a Doberman that could handle cold weather. Some of the recommendations to me were...
Let me stop it for a second. Listen, I'm going to tell you, this guy must watch documentary TV because he basically described the kind of dogs that I love and the kind of videos that I work to produce. To me, and this is just my honest opinion, I feel like if you're getting a dog to be a part of your family, I mean, you really want that dog to have some other value to the family. And I think protection or deterrence against aggression, because protection is, you know, protection might mean actually going out and training a dog and you know, actually getting some protection training done. But there's also what I call deterrence, you know, and that is the fact that it is commonly known that most homes with big dogs don't get broken into. It's just statistical data at this point. So I think, you know, this guy's on the right track in what he's looking for. I'm halfway through the video. He's going from a Doberman Pinscher, and he's looking at getting a giant schnauzer. I think he's asking for, at least in my opinion, all the right things in a dog. Athleticism, family dog. I live in Southern California. I'm not so much worried about or concerned about the weather. It seemed like he was in California too when he said his Doberman was having issues with cold weather. I've never really seen Dobermans. That was one thing that I was thinking, like maybe his dog had another issue, because even when it gets cold, and I've been up to Northern California and filmed Dobermans up there, they don't seem to, and Northern California gets a lot colder than Southern California, especially in the winter. And they don't seem to have too big an issue dealing with California winters. Now, our winters really might only get down into the 40s and 30s at the coldest at night. So that's cold, but it's not necessarily extremely cold. And an idea, I would think that most Californians, we're bringing our dogs in anyway. If you have a dog that's, you know, there to protect the house, he should be in the house anyway. So I don't know. Like, I definitely feel like this guy is looking for the right things. I think he's a good candidate for someone that watches documentary TV, because those are the kind of videos, those are the dogs that I love, and those are the kind of videos I try to produce. Let's continue.
Your typical Mastiff and Bully breeds, Pit Bulls were always recommended to me by a lot of people, but they have short hair, and in fairness, generally speaking, they're not that intelligent. Great Danes, very large, not as athletic as I would want, short hair. Dogo Argentino, again, probably checks all the same marks. Short hair, though, can't handle the cold. Cane Corsos, which are very cool looking, short hair, probably not as athletic. I've seen some athletic ones, but generally not that athletic. And then because I live in Georgia, the Bulldog was recommended.
But he's in Georgia.
You know, that didn't cut it either. Some other breeds, Rhodesian Ridgeback was mentioned, Boxer, A Rottweiler was a good choice, generally, though. They're very smart, but I don't dig the athleticism. They're not as athletic as I'd want. So I got used to Kaza being able to just bound over a 4-foot fence without touching it. And I kind of wanted to go in that direction again. The last was the
Let me say one thing. Not to go full Rottweiler lover on him. But first and foremost, I have a Rottweiler, right? So we're going to step up and we're going to speak up on the Rottweiler. And I agree with you as well. I saw, I think it was Doug in the comment section said that, you know, that pit bulls aren't that intelligent. Who said that? That was Super Pack. He said that. This dude is delusional. Pit bulls are not intelligent. This dude is delusional saying pit bulls are not, saying that they're not intelligent. Right, yeah. I would definitely agree. Pit bulls are very clever dogs. They're smart. They're not, see, sometimes we as human beings define intelligence as ability to follow an order. To me, as somebody that kind of has been around a lot of different dogs, a lot of different dog breeds, bred for a lot of different things, I define dog's intelligence as his ability to solve problems. And not necessarily the problems that I need him to solve. Like sometimes you put a problem in front of a dog thinking it might keep him in a room, might keep him in a backyard. He solves it and he gets outside. That dog's not dumb. That dog is actually highly intelligent. And a lot of us might get upset and say, oh, this stupid dog keeps jumping the fence. You know, and he got, you know, whatever. He got picked up by the dog catcher or whatever. And we think that makes him dumb. But that's not dumb. That's actually a smart dog because the dog figured out what he wanted and got it done. So I think a lot of times people say dogs like pit bulls, bulldogs, some of these other, and not necessarily, the bulldogs aren't that smart, I'm sorry, I will say that. Like, at least the English bulldog, they're not super dumb. They're not as dumb as people would make you think they are. But dogs' intelligence should be measured against their ability to solve problems and not necessarily their ability to follow directions. That's what I've come to believe and understand. But back to this whole thing with the Rottweiler and Rottweilers can be very athletic. If you feed them and keep them at a proper weight, they are super athletic. A 4-foot fence. I have a Rottweiler right now. In my backyard, I have a 6-foot fence because if my fence was only 4 feet, he would jump over it and he would meet me in the front yard every time I came home. I have a truck bed that is about 39 inches off the ground. He easily jumps into the back of my truck on command. So the idea that the Rottweilers aren't athletic is not something that I'm letting fly on my channel as a Rottweiler lover. That's my prerogative. And I'm not saying that it's not a great choice, because I think it is. Let's continue watching the video. I'm sorry, give me 1 second. I messed up.
Those were one way or another recommended. They just don't have the presence that I would want in a dog. The breeds I was considering, number one was the Dutch Shepherd. I think it has a better presence than the Malinois, but the Malinois was also considered. These are very smart police dogs, and the German Shepherd was the other one. I've seen some very impressive ones, some with shorter hair than others, but generally I couldn't really find any that, you know, from a quick search, I couldn't find any that were short hair and didn't shed everywhere. Border Collie was also considered, however, they're just not as intimidating. They're the smartest dogs there are. They do shed, but they're just not, they don't have the presence.
All right, now this dude, he kind of getting all over the place with dogs. Like, he was on the fringe when you started talking about Malinois, when you're going from the Doberman Pinscher. I understand how you get from Doberman Pinscher to Malinois, but I don't understand how you get to Doberman Pinscher to Border Collie. That's not something that makes sense to me.
I wanted. What basically happened is as I did my research, I started seeing this black dog that was doing bite work. And my research, it was said it was a police dog. It was the Giant Schnauzer. And as I started reading the description, one way or another, it did come across as basically a furry Doberman. And so that is where I kind of set my sights on. I don't think giant schnauzer owners that I've, the few I've come in contact with, they would call them furry Dobermans at all. They're their own thing. But there is a, on paper, in my opinion, they share a lot of similar traits. Some more in one area than the other, but they're all kind of there. So anyway, we ended up with Tux, short for tuxedo, because he has a little white on his chin. And he came from a very good kennel. And as luck would have it, I didn't think I'd be getting a dog for the next few months based on how I ended up with Kazi. But I put in a an application, and immediately I got contacted, and the kennel happened to be less than 5 miles from where I was going to go with my family on vacation. So everything just fell into place. But that is, in short, how we ended up with a giant schnauzer puppy. By all means, I am not a dog expert. I was an expert on just my dog, Kazi. I wouldn't even claim to be an expert on Dobermans, just my Doberman. And this is my first giant schnauzer, and I will become an expert on just him. But this was my criteria. Again, I wanted a family dog that was also a very capable guard dog. It had to be athletic, and it had to have a presence. Part of what made me choose Tux is there was two puppies available. He was the one with the cropped ears. He also had the little more of a dominant demeanor of the two, so that kind of helped. But the presence is something I wanted. The cropped ears and the dark tail and the stance. I want people to see that dog and come to a stop. The last thing is he does have a nice furry coat. Doesn't shed. I haven't had his hair on me at all. Like, he smells when he gets into stuff, but he's not shedding hair everywhere. And so if we end up in a cold weather place, or even when winter comes here to Georgia, he should be fine. So, but that is it. That is the criteria. That is how we end up with a giant schnauzer. And I'm looking forward to raising him the way I raised Kazi. I think he's going to be a very good family dog. I think he's going to be a very good guard dog. I'm looking forward to training him in all those areas and documenting it and sharing it here, along with everything else I put on this channel. So, anyway, I hope you enjoyed this, and I hope I didn't offend anyone with my rationale. I know there's a lot of wonderful dogs out there and a lot of wonderful breeds. But this is how I ended up going from Doberman to Giant Schnauzer and why. So anyway, I hope you like this video. If you have questions for me, please leave them in the comments. I'd love to answer them. And I will see you guys next time. Bye.
All right, very cool, very cool. So that dude, his name is David Windmuller. If you guys are interested in the Giant Schnauzer breed, check out his channel. It could probably be another source of information for you, source of insight into the breed. Listening to his reasoning and how he went from the Doberman to the Giant Schnauzer, nothing but respect for that. It seems like a guy that's reasonable, logical, and kind of went through the steps. Like I said, there were some breeds in his pool of candidates that I would say were a little out of pocket. I wonder, if his dog, his Doberman didn't have another issue, because I don't think Dobermans, I mean, unless you're like in like some serious, I don't know how cold it gets in Georgia. I'm sure it gets cold sometimes, but it shouldn't be an issue. It shouldn't be a place where, it's not Minnesota, right? So it's not cold all the time. So if your dog is cold when it gets into the 20s or the teens, yeah, I'm going to say most short-haired dogs would be cold at that point. All in all, I think he made a good choice. I love giant schnauzers. They're a great breed. They are everything that I want in a dog, except for they do have, I don't want to have to groom my dog, every 3 or 4 months. I don't want to have serious grooming costs. So I never looked at getting a giant schnauzer. All right, guys, we're going to continue to move on. So moving forward, we're going to take a vote. You guys tell me what you guys want to see next. I have two documentary TV videos popping up or on the menu for you today. One is a very old documentary TV, so old that it's actually a Bully Badass TV video. It's a Warble video. Another video I wanted to watch today is my one. I think it's probably not my most recent video, but posted within the last 30 days for sure. A Great Dane video. So you guys in the comment section, let me know what you want to see. You guys want to see Warbles or you want to see Great Danes? We're going to take a little bit of time and see what's going on with your comments. See what you guys want to watch. Let's see what you guys are talking about in the comment section. Shout out to Khalid, the Fun Kid, Patrick, Super Pack, Melinda Lee. Kaboom wants to see Warbles. I make a prediction that in 6 months, this guy's dog is going to be so down and aggressive. I don't believe that. Yeah. Well, we got two votes already for the Warble. Lisa Wolf, what is a German niece? I never heard of that. I'm sure it must be a German Shepherd mixed with something, right? Definitely not a Pekingese, I'm sure, right? What is that? What's the crossbreed of that? What are those? Let me go ahead and set up this, get ready to set up this. Uh-oh, Dexter just voted for Great Dane. All right, first one to five votes. That's what we're going to do. We got three votes for the board, but we got one vote for the Great Dane. Let's go. Come on, guys. What y'all want to see? There's 52 people in here. Let's go. It's your show to direct. You tell me what's next. Isaac says Warble. So we're 4-1, Dexter. I need one more vote or four more votes. Warble. There it is. It's done deal. Let's watch this Warble video, guys. So let me just take you guys there, and then I'll go here. All right. Boom.
You're watching Bully Badass TV, YouTube's best channel for dog lovers.
All right, before this video starts, let me tell you guys some things about this video. First and foremost, this is in Napa Valley, California. This is about a 5.5-6 hour drive from where I live at in Southern California. So this right here was an adventure. At this point in time in my life, I have one kid. I don't have two kids, I have one kid. So I was excited. Maybe I do have two kids. When did this video? No, actually, I'm sorry. I take that back. I have two kids. I do have two kids. I did this in 17. My daughter was born in 14. So I know I have two kids at this point. I thought this was done sooner than that. But regardless, one of my first jump in the truck, drive 6 hours, film. I just bought a drone. I was so excited to use it. When you get out into places like this, you can fly drones. Because these people had, I believe they had like 10 or 15 acres, so I could put it up and not necessarily worry about going into someone else's property. But anyway, one of the early videos of Bully Badass TV before it switched to documentary TV. But obviously I had made the switch in my head because I was doing a breed that was a non-bully breed. All right, guys. And also, let me just say this. At this point in my life, I've only seen one or two Warbles in my life, and I had never really interacted with them. I just kind of seen them on at dog shows. So this is kind of my first real experience with the breed, and I spent a day up there actually. That drone shot is sick.
I'm Jennifer Fuller, and I own Fuller Borbles in Mariposa.
And I'm Kim Bazaar, and I have Gallant Borbles, and I'm out of Atwater, California.
So Kim and I met through the Borbles, realized that we were pretty close together, and since that time, since we met, we've worked a lot together in finding the right Borbles to complement our breeding programs. My husband and I owned a Mastiff mix. He lived to be 16 years old. When we moved up here from the city, we realized what an incredible dog he was. He protected us. He would go with the kids on hikes out on this property. And when he got to the age of getting close to passing away, we started researching Mastiff breeds that met his temperament. Not by looks or anything like that, but purely by temperament. And the Borble best described that. About 2 years after we started researching the breed, we brought home our first one. We moved here 20 years ago, and with our other dogs that we had prior to the Borbles, we would have, you know, bears getting into the trash can all the time and things such as that. There would be a lot of evidence of mountain lions taking down deer close by the house. And once we got the Borbles, we saw that diminish greatly. The Borbles have an incredible sense of smell. We can be in the house and they can all of a sudden throw their nose up in the air and know that there's a large animal outside, which is kind of neat. It made me feel, I was a city girl. I didn't grow up in the mountains, so coming up here was a little scary for me, and that really helped me to feel safe. I love that I can take, you know, one or two dogs and we can go outside of the fence and go on a hike right here. Good exercise for them. They have 3 yards that they can just stretch their legs in and run and wrestle. They are big wrestlers. They love to do that, and we just let them. So right now my pack consists of 6 dogs total. I have 2 males and 4 females. This is Zuri. Zuri? He's my alpha male. He's the oldest. He is 6 years old. He's a strong male. He does not like everybody he meets. He can be very protective, and so we are cautious with him with people. We typically like to introduce through the fence, over the fence, not just have somebody walk in. And then this is Johari. She's my alpha female, and she's almost 6 years old, and this is going to be her last litter. She produces some beautiful puppies, and you'll meet one of them a little bit later, my male Boo. And we also have her granddaughter here on campus, so I'm not going to make her do too much today because she's due to have puppies next week and I don't want her working too hard. The great thing about Zuri is that he, conformationally, he's really nice. His head could be a little more square, but because he is so thick, he doesn't move nearly as well as his son, who has a much more athletic build. So. But conformation wise, he has great conformation. He scores well. He's got decent, he could be better in rear angulation, which is pretty typical for Borbles. We lack rear angulation. But other than that, he's a solid dog. So this male is a son of my older male, and they played together, they did everything together until this guy started mating. And then he got a little cocky. Got a little bit of an attitude. And although there was never any incident or fight, I could just tell that their relationship had changed. So I don't allow them to have direct contact. They can be separated by a baby gate and they're fine. Fence to fence, they're fine. They can be nose to nose through a fence, they're fine. It's just I'm overcautious and don't want to take that chance. I have had male Borble fights before where we've had an older male come in as an older male and break through the fence to get to my male, and male Borble fights are horrible. They're a mess. Even with the females, sometimes even though they all can be hanging out in the living room together, there are certain times when we do separate them and shuffle them because heat cycles, they get moody. Pregnancies, they can get moody. And so there's just different times. Said my dogs do live in the home, so typically if I have everybody in the house, one male would be behind a baby gate in a bedroom and the other male would be out, and then I just switch them out so they each get pack time. We have Boo. He is almost 29 inches at the shoulder and he's between 145 and 150.
He is a therapy certified dog. He loves therapy visits, but he's also incredibly intense. So anything that Boo does, he does pretty intensely. Stay. Stand. You see, his build is far more athletic than his dad. He can move much better and quicker. His negatives are his angulation, of course. If I could change anything about him, I'd give him more rear angulation. But other than that, his front, Boo. Come here. His head is really nice. He's got a beautiful front. He's got a straight front. A lot of times what we're seeing is the easty-westy feet, and you don't want to see that. It's really bad. It's poor. So nice straight front. He's wanting to. This one has a pretty high prey drive. And, well, actually, all three of these have a pretty high prey play drive. Boo is an offspring from Zuri and Johari. This is Subi, or Sabira. I brought her in from Michigan. Subi is 4 years old, going on 5. And she would be the one that I would call the most feisty. She has the most gumption. She's the one most likely to take off your hand if you reach over the fence. She's small. She is only 23 and a half inches at the shoulder, and she runs about 110, 115. We love her. She's, like I said, most protective, most intense. She's just a really great dog. Subi. Kai, come. Hey. And this is their daughter, Kai. So Kai is my third generation. Confirmationally, she hasn't been scored yet. She's 4 months old. She'll be scored this spring. But confirmationally, she's pretty darn correct. She's a pretty nice dog. Nice straight front. When she stands right, she's got decent angulation. It's not perfect, but it's decent. It's good. She's got a nice head. She's a nice female. The baby of the pack is Ama, and she was just imported from South Africa along with her sister Cosmo, who Kim owns. And they are 5 months now. They're a little different than what we're used to. They're incredibly high energy.
The reason we imported the dogs from South Africa was to improve on the rear angulation, also to improve on the lines. We needed to broaden our lines of the lineage of the Borbles.
You can get a lot of varying thoughts on where the breed really originated. Basically, it came over on the Great Trek to South Africa, the dogs, the Mastiffs that they brought with them, the hunting dogs, mated with the South African native dogs, and somehow along the way the breed began. Mm-hmm. 1950 is when they really started focusing on, I have the name written down, Diego started focusing on breeding them. After that, it wasn't until 1983 when they decided to gather a select number of these dogs, name them, make them a breed, and breed them specifically for their job as farm protectors.
I would say they're the best Mastiff for farm protection and guardians. If you have livestock or you have property that you need to protect, but for just the average dog owner, they're not the best Mastiff. They are a lot of work, a lot of socialization, a lot of training. They are a lot of work.
I would say that there's many different aspects to the Borble community. When you say community, I think of one big community that's bound together by one set of goals, and I don't think that's true in the Borble breed. I think that there's many sub-communities within the Borble breed.
Okay.
So, you know, there's some who really only believe they should be farm dogs, purely farm dogs. There's others that are doing different things, competing, sports, dog sports. Several of mine are therapy dogs. They could do therapy visits. So there's just a huge variety. My objective with the breed is to continue. I don't want to water them down so much that they're not what they should be. I mean, they have to maintain that protective instinct. There are a few that don't, you know, and there's a few that are overboard. So, and they're working dogs.
They should be able to work if you ask them to work. That work could be multiple things. It could be dock jumping, it could be, farming, it could be moving firewood, it could be pulling a sled, it could be the guardian protection, it could be going on a therapy visit and visiting people could be their work. So they are a working dog, and if you don't keep them working doing something, they tend to get bored and destructive. Like I said, I have a couple that are therapy dogs. I have a couple that could not be therapy dogs. So I want to keep their working ability. I want to keep them lean and athletic. They need to be able to move and do their job. And they can't protect if they can't get up off the couch. If you think about what the original purpose of the breed was, it is to be on the farm and protect the livestock. And they would do that in packs. You wouldn't have a single Borble out there protecting against, a hyena or lion. They would do that in packs. So therefore, the Borbles had to be able to think on their own and do the job without being directed. But in the home environment, in the pet environment, you don't really want them to be free thinkers. You don't want them taking over, because they will. They are dominant. They will try to direct your home to get what they want and to rule the roost. And oftentimes, their dominance is overlooked because they can be very well behaved. So you don't really notice that. It's really important to have a bond with your breeders to help you understand when those situations come and when they hit. And it can, suddenly a 10-month-old male can start showing severe dominance because the boundaries have not been set from day one. The dog hasn't been made to follow guidelines and rules. And because they're so cute and adorable as puppies, they've kind of pushed their way into the leadership role of the family in the household. Some of the signs of your dog ruling the roost, it can start very subtly. In the beginning, by pushing through a door in front of you, not obeying on the first command, refusing to eat in certain places, refusing certain food so that you feel bad for the puppy and you give it what it wants. And it can escalate all the way up to your own dog growling at you, barking, biting, showing dominance with visitors, and that type of thing.
Both of us feed our Borbles strictly raw. It's a prey model raw. We have found that the dogs are much healthier. We have less incidence of any kind of health problems. It seems to be about the same cost when you look at it health-wise as a good quality kibble. We just like the raw. It's a little bit of work, but it seems to be worth it in the long run. I'm Kim with Gallant Borbles, Atwater, California. Thanks for watching the video. Hopefully you learned something about Borbles. If you have any other questions, feel free to visit our website. Mine is agallantborble.com. And hopefully you learned something about this great breed. If you have any questions, contact one of us.
And I'm Jennifer. Thank you so much for watching. What I hope you took away from this is that a Borble's not for everybody, but if you do think that a Borble will be right for you, we encourage you to seek a breeder that's going to work with you, that's going to be with you in the long haul, that's going to stick by your side and be there through the life of the Borble to help you and assist you with your questions and answers. We are FullerBorbles.com, and we're in Mariposa, California, and I love answering questions about the dogs. Anytime you want to give a call, we're available.
All right, very cool. Man, that video brought back so many memories for me. It's like I said, it was one of my very first adventures in filmmaking and all that stuff with the documentary TV channel. There was a lot of things said. And H Town, I'm gonna get to you in a second. I saw your question. I'm not gonna ask your question, but I want to address your question. And I'm making you somewhat of an answer. I don't know. We'll talk about it in a second. But let me wrap up this video real quick. I love the Borbles. I love the South African Mastiff. These are great dogs. If you look at them, in and out of the show ring, I still don't feel like they're perfect yet in terms of their structure, at least the ones that are available here in the States. I should actually see if I can find Fuller now, because they were, one of their biggest problems with their dogs was the rear angulation. I saw that they were addressing that in their younger dogs, so that might be something they may have fixed already, and I just haven't seen it. But they are a dog with a very rich past. They have a lot of what I always look at as like genetic information, meaning that there's a lot of things that these dogs inherently want to do, can do. And because they have so many things, they're farm dogs, right? They're you know, so that means they have a little bit of herder in them. They're not herders, they're probably more like drovers. They're guardians. They're like dogs that are what do you call it? I don't know what you call it. Like cart dogs, pull carts. They're fighters, because obviously guardians, they got to fight. Sometimes they got to fight each other. Sometimes they got to fight predators. Sometimes they got to fight pests, you know. But they're a very complicated dog, very well-rounded dog. If I had a need for that, like if I lived on a piece of property where I had like wild animals, whether it be raccoons, possums, skunks, coyotes, I would definitely look at getting a Borbal. I think those are the kind of dogs that you need for that kind of environment. Borbal, Cane Corso, Presses, those are the kind of dogs. You would then have to figure out, based on your personality, your dog experience, your temperament, your family conditions, all these things, which breed you would choose. But those would be the dogs I would start if I had a farm. I don't have a farm. I got a Rottweiler. But anyway, I love the Borbal. And then someday I might just get a Borbal for the experiment of owning a Borbal, because I just want one. I just want one. They're beautiful dogs, and it's something that I want. All right, real quick. During that video, while we were watching that video, H-Town 11 asked me a question, which I'm going to address. I don't know. It's the question that I dread most. I get asked this question 1,000 times in emails, in comment sections. It's a great question. It's a question that makes sense, except it doesn't. And his question was, give me a suggestion for the best family dog for my apartment living. I have a wife and two sons. That's you. That's a family of four, basically. And the problem with that question is, like, I understand dogs. I know dogs. But what I don't know is you. I don't know your wife. I don't know your kids. So I could recommend a dog, but if they don't fit your wife, your kids, or you, it's going to be a horrible situation. So that's why I hate answering that question. I understand why people ask it all the time, but I try to explain to people, like, if I don't know you, if I don't know, like, you know, where you work at, when are you home, you know what I'm saying, what time do you go to sleep, how early do you get up, are you a person that is... can you assume the alpha role in a family? Will your dog, will a dog assume that you're alpha? Do you have that kind of personality? You have that kind, those kind of characteristics? So that makes it so hard to recommend dogs to people. And I really hate doing it, because I feel like, in a lot of ways, I'm doing the person a disservice. And in some cases, I'm doing the dog a disservice as well. So H-Town 11, I don't really know, like, if someone had asked if you were active. And that is a component of what kind of dog is best suited for you. What's your level of activity? But I just, me personally, I'm never comfortable really answering that question when I don't know the person. And because I don't know you, I don't want to recommend a dog for you. There are a lot of good dogs that you can look into for apartment living, you know, and... I would just recommend that you not be afraid of bigger dogs. I don't know how big it's, again, I don't know how big your apartment is. But I had a very small apartment, and I could have lived with Roscoe, my big dog, in it, because inside the house, he's a Rottweiler. Inside the house, he doesn't move much. My older dog, Bernie, he's a pit mix. We lived in an apartment together. He was probably less suitable for apartment living than my older dog. Than my bigger dog, my Rottweiler. And I say that because Bernie would catch zoomies. Bernie needed to be walked. You know, when I first got Bernie, I was walking him 5 to 7 miles a day just to keep him calm in the house. But it worked. It worked out. Like, it was good for me. I was definitely smaller. I was more fit. I was single at the time, so I didn't have wife and kids to be worrying about, and it was just me and him. So it worked out, and it was great for us at that time. And he was a friendly dog, right? That's another thing. So when I lived in an apartment, I would meet people, and I lived in an apartment. I was single, so I was meeting women and people all the time. And you bring him into the house, you know, like, that worked out for me because Bernie wasn't at all protective of the house. He just didn't care. You know, he was a very friendly dog. You bring a woman in there, he loved her. He was sitting there like he knew her. Roscoe, when people come to the house, very protective. He's going to start barking at you. So I guess what I'm saying is that there's so many different variables. It's hard to recommend dogs to people you don't know and you don't know their situation. I would just suggest that you, knowing yourself, get as much information as you can get, figure out what kind of dog you like, what kind of temperament you like, what kind of activities you like, what you need a dog to do, what kind of work you need a dog to do, what's your living situation, how many people are coming and going from your house. You know what I'm saying? If you got a lot of strange people coming and go, like when I say strange people, I mean like you meeting a lot of people coming and going, you might not want a Cane Corso, a Rottweiler, a Master Breed, because they're not necessarily good with new people. Like I said, there's so many different variables. It's really hard to tell you what you should get, what you shouldn't get. And that's why for me personally, I try to avoid answering that question. I just recommend do your research. Put no breed off the table because, first of all, start with what you like, right? What kind of breed do you want? Because that's the kind of breed that's going to enhance your life. It's going to be something that you're always comfortable with. You're going to always be happy to look at and happy to see. But then just make sure that it does. It ticks all the boxes in terms of, one, the social, the way the dog interacts socially with the way you interact socially, and then the work that you want to do in terms of that. Getting a little choked up because Mohawk asked me, is Bernie still alive? Bernie is still. Is Bernie in? No, they're both of the dogs are outside right now. The sun's gone down, so it's cool. So I leave them outside. I'm in my office there in the backyard. Yes, Bernie is still alive. He's going to be 16 years old in January. And it's crazy because I didn't even expect that he was going to live past 10 years. Like when I got him, he was 2. And my assumption is that, oh, dogs live to be like 10, 11 years old. You know, so I'm kind of, you know, I'm proud of the fact that, you know, I've gotten him to 17 years old. It breaks, 16 years old rather. It breaks my heart though, as I see him getting older. It's crazy. He's old. Like last year, this year, actually, I'm sorry, not last year, but the last spring, he went through something, right? They basically called it old dog's disease, where he lost his balance, and I thought he was dying. I didn't know what was going on, but it lasted for about 6 weeks. Well, it lasted for about a week. He recovered. It took him about 6 weeks to recover. Now, he's just an old dog again. Like he's not as dizzy, you know. Like literally, for 6 weeks he would fall off the stairs. Like I have 2 steps going from my backyard to my house. He would literally, in going up those, navigating those 2 stairs, find a way to fall off. But now he's better, and you know, like I said, he's going to be 16 in January. Very proud of the fact that you know he's still, you know, a happy dog. At 15 years old. And, you know, it just goes to show you what a raw food diet will do for a dog. I think that's part of the reason why I think that's one of the reasons why he's gotten so far is that I feed him raw food, and he has pretty much an easy life. At this point, Bernie is, after his issue in the spring, I took him to the vet. They diagnosed him with a whole bunch of things. He has heart issues, kidney issues. What else does he have? Heart issues, kidney issues. Then he had that cognitive thing with the old dog's disease thing. Anyway, he's no longer on a raw diet. He's for the last, since the spring, he's on kibble and like a wet food. But basically, it's for his kidneys. It's to, you know, like to take some of the stress off his kidneys. So he's no longer raw fed, but I did feed him raw for roughly 11 years, and I think that's what's got him to where he's at right now. Roscoe, my Rottweiler, he's only 4. He's still on a raw diet. What's up, Dong My Wow? How you doing, my brother? Let's see. All right, guys, we got one more video to check out before we're gonna call it a night. And this is a recent video. I know you guys didn't. You guys weren't as excited about seeing the Great Dane. But let me tell you something about Great Danes. To me, Great Danes are like a. You guys need to put some more respect on the Great Dane first and foremost. A lot of you guys seem to dismiss it. A lot of you guys seem to. Yeah, basically dismiss it. Say it's overbred, it's not working anymore, all this other stuff. And listen, I talk to people all the time that work dogs. And I'll be honest, and I'll be up front and say, like, yeah, there's not a lot of 100% pure Great Danes working. But a lot of people working these hogs are using Great Danes in their programs. And they're getting them from show breeders. Because they need the structure. They need that solid structure. They obviously need the temperament. They come from someplace else. But they need that structure in the Great Dane. They need that size of the Great Dane. So I actually have a video. I wish I had thought about this before we had this, before I went live. Because I would tell you which video it is. It's like a podcast I did with a guy out of Texas. I think his name was Bob Dean or something like that. He's out of Texas. And he hunts with Great Dane mixes. And he spoke very highly of him. That's a great podcast. I think if you guys are interested in Great Danes or hunting, hog hunting, he does hog hunting with it. I think you guys should check it out. I'll see if I can figure it out how to. At this point, I kind of blew it. I should have had that information right now, but I don't. But anyway, let's get into this next video. This is a woman out of San Diego, California. She has beautiful Great Danes. I think they are very well put together. I'm just talking aesthetically, the phenotype, the look of them. I don't know if they work or how hard they work. I'm sure they work on some level. I don't know how hard they work, which is probably more of a nuanced question for someone who actually works dogs to figure out. But let's jump into this next video. Let me see if I can find it.
You're watching.
Yeah, we're going to stop that T. There we go.
Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
Jennifer Costantinidis of Dunn Roman Danes. Great Danes are my passion. These Danes are born into my hands. For me, the beginning of a Great Dane like this one starts from before she's born, with the creation of her, putting together two pedigrees I believe are going to blend well to give me type, soundness, and a complete animal that will be sound of mind and body, and then breeding, whelping, and raising the litter. And that's just the beginning. I brought 3 with me. The first female is laying at my feet. This is Grand Champion Dunn Romans, just like you, only prettier, CGC TKN. And Miranda is not only a show dog, she is my companion, my best hiking buddy, and one of my best friends. She is the mother of a 10-month-old litter that I am now currently showing one of those puppies in Bred by Exhibitor. The second female is Champion Birdie, who is Champion Dunroman's Keeping It Fly, CGC-TKN, and she is the mother of the 4-month-old puppy that I brought with me today. The 4-month-old puppy is by our number 5 Great Dane from last year, BISS Grand Champion Silver Champion Dunroman's Jackpot, I Love You 3000, AOM, and that's Tony, and he is the sire of Harley, and Birdie is the dam. A lot of people think that Great Danes are goofy and fun like Scooby or Marmaduke. And I would like the general population of the world to know that a Great Dane shows in the working group because it is a working dog. It was bred to do a function and it was bred to work. It should be intelligent, trainable, and it should not behave like goofy or not intelligent. Some of the males can be a little goofy as they're growing up, but a Great Dane should be an intelligent, trainable animal. They bring me joy, laughter, security. I will take 3 Great Danes and hike anywhere. I don't worry about what I'm going to encounter on a trail when I'm hiking with 3 working dogs. Their energy and my energy is very well matched because I have bursts of energy, but I'm not a constant source of energy. So we could go out, we can hike 3 to 5 miles, and then we could come back and relax. And I just find that the breed is well suited for me and how I'm wired. Nutritionally, we feed a high quality kibble, but I do add supplements, and I also add blueberries, fresh proteins, beef, chicken on occasion. But you need to feed a high quality kibble, and you need to do a lot of research on dog food because some dog foods are marketed very well, but they're nutritionally lacking. The biggest health concern I would say for the breed would be bloat. And how that can be addressed is you can electively gastropexy your Great Dane when it becomes an adult and take that off the table. After a Great Dane is gastropexied, they can bloat, but they will not torsion. And it's torsion that is deadly. That would be one of the biggest concerns in the breed, provided you purchase from a breeder who does echocardiograms and has x-rayed the hips, elbows, and done the thyroid. If you've done your research on your breeder, one of the things that no breeder of a deep-chested dog, giant breed or otherwise, could take completely off the table is bloat and torsion. If you are looking for a Great Dane puppy, the first thing to do is reach out to lots of breeders and see who you have a rapport with. The second thing to do would be to meet their dogs and see who's appealing to you. Also, to see how their dogs behave. You do not want to purchase a puppy from someone who has dogs that behave in a way that wouldn't be suitable to your lifestyle. After all of that, you want to make sure that the dogs have been properly health tested. So if you go to the Great Dane Club of America website, it will give you a list of reputable breeders across the U.S. And then you can go on to the Orthopedic Foundation of America and check all their health testing. I would also ask about the puppy's sire and dam's grandparents and also vertical pedigree, because history is the best guess at the future. I have rescued a couple Great Danes because I feel preservationist breeders also have to give back to the breed. Rescue is a very tricky question because as a breeder, and this could be an unpopular opinion, I don't believe all dogs should be rescued. I believe that if a dog has bit people or is a threat to human beings, that that dog should not be rescued, that the kindest thing to do would be to euthanize it. And that's not a popular opinion, but you're not dealing with a Chihuahua. You're dealing with an animal over 100 pounds that could be a lethal weapon and is capable of taking someone's life. So I think you should approach rescue very carefully, and you should build a rapport with someone running a rescue that you feel is forthright and is dog savvy enough to properly evaluate and place a Great Dane, because not all rescues are the same. And I don't like to see this breed involved in anything unsavory. If you want to learn more about the breed, you can visit the Great Dane Club of America website. You could also look for your local breed club. So I'm a part of the Great Dane Club of San Diego. There are clubs all across the United States with dedicated people that are trying to further the education and best interest of the breed. You could reach out to them. I would also say that you could contact a breeder and ask them if they have anyone living in your area with one of their dogs that you could go meet or reach out to and ask them what their experience has been as a Great Dane owner. The breed is not for everyone. With a dog this size comes great responsibility. So if you don't want to spend time training, or you're very busy and you don't have time to socialize, this is not a breed that you would be well suited for. You need owners that are dedicated to bringing them upright. Thank you for watching today. You can locate us on Instagram at Dunn Roman Danes, or you can find me on social media on Facebook, Jennifer Costantinidis.
All right, very cool, very cool. Now, that was one of my more recent videos. Hope you guys appreciate it. Oh, man. Yes, that color, the black and white is Harlequin. Mohawk. Yeah, I think a lot of you guys are sleeping on the Great Dane. I truly believe that it's a big dog, so that obviously having a dog that size working is going to be a more rare kind of situation, you know what I'm saying? Because obviously the bigger dogs, bigger damage, right? And working dogs are not necessarily, they're not for everyone. They're not for everyone, plain and period. So as the dogs get bigger, one second, my wife just texted me. But as the dogs get bigger, you want them to be safer. So I understand why the Great Danes aren't necessarily bred so much for working. But like I said, there are a lot of people out there crossing them with other breeds, Cane Corsos, bull breeds, pit bull terriers, to make for like spectacular catch dogs. So that's what's up with that. All right, guys, we're coming to the end of the show. We're hour and about 20 minutes into this. I want to say thank you to everybody that jumped in. Big shots out to Chico Lopez for the super chat. I appreciate you, my brother. Everyone that commented, everyone that liked the video, thank you guys so much. I'm going to try to do this again tomorrow. I do have softball, soccer, and flag football tomorrow, but I'm going to try to find some time to hop on live and we can watch some more videos together. We can talk dogs. We can kind of figure out. I'm really trying to figure out a way to make this a show, to make myself an on-air personality. I'm working on it. You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to get myself some structure, some things to do, some things to talk about. Pretty soon, I'm going to be bringing on some guests, doing some interviews, stuff like that. But in the meantime and in between time, thank you guys so much for spending the evening with me. Houston 11, hopefully, you know, you find that dog you're looking for. I do apologize for probably not giving you the best answer or giving you a precise answer. Like I said, it's very hard to tell somebody what's the best dog for them when you don't even know who they are. Mohawk, I did a Chinese Red Dog video. The Chinese Red Dog video I did was from dogs over in England. So it's kind of a Zoom video, but there's a lot of footage, a lot of his dogs working in action, and we did an interview. So just do a search for Dogumentary TV/Chinese Red Dogs YouTube. It should pop up. All right, guys, thanks again so much. I appreciate you guys. You guys have a wonderful weekend. I'll see you guys tomorrow.